Hello everyone, welcome back to Excel ERP. Today we are starting our second series of developing the Excel ERP application. And the second basic step would be the creating of database and adding users to it. So we are going to cover, we'll create a database, we'll add a users table, and in the VBA we'll set up the connections and we'll check some login condition to grant the login access to the user. A little bit more in detail, what we are going to cover in Access database, we'll set up ADO connections, Active Data Object Connections, we'll create the user tables, we'll create the macro for granting login access to the users, and we'll read the user's information, whatever we are creating in the database, directly from the database and not putting the putting it temporarily in the Excel sheet. So this is what all we'll go through today. Let's start by how it works. This is what we covered in our last series of developing the design part. So let's say if we log in, now the menu appears here. As soon as I log out, the menu goes away. That's how we are doing it. So we go to the users part. This is the user information part we developed. So we can read what all users we added, and similarly we can read each user's information. This all the data is coming directly from our database and not from this list box or the sheet. So we'll see how all this coding works and we'll see how we create the database file. So to create the new database file, we can open the Access, Microsoft Access, we create the blank database. Let's say it's, you can name anything, DBTemp, and we can save it on, let's say, desktop. Let's create this. So this is how the new database will be created. We can close this. We will create the users table from our Excel sheet, where we put in all the data of the users, and we'll directly import it in the Access database, and the table will be created automatically. So this is the user table that we created. So this is the arbitrary temporary data, and we assign put some values, some information of each user. This user is active or not inactive, you know, it is the user type, is admin or non-admin. We can use it in multiple purposes, and first name, last name, email ID, designation, department, porting to, date of joining, mobile phone, next phone, and date of birth, and the password. So I purposefully kept the password in the last, and I'll explain why I did so. So this is the table we created in Excel sheet, and we'll import the sheet in the Excel database, Access database. So let's say external sources, we'll go to the external sources in Access, create a new data source from file Excel, we'll browse for the file. This is the file, click OK. Sheet number one, this is our sheet, this is the data we want to import. So go to next, the first row contain column heading. If the first row is our column heading, then we can check this. First row contain column heading. So our first row will be treated as the field headers in the Excel table, in the Access table. So let's click next. So here the user ID should be indexed to no duplicates. The user ID, no two user can have the same user ID. So this is what it means. It should be indexed with no duplicates, and the data type would be short text. There are different data types available depending upon what kind of data we are importing. So at status, or we are clicking on each field, each column, and we can see whether it is to be indexed or not. And if we want to change the field name, we can change it here. And if we want to change the data type, we can change it here. Also, if we don't want to import any particular field, we can simply check do not import this field. Short text, email ID also should be indexed to no duplicates. Designation, department, similarly we check every date of joining should be date and time, date with time. It can be mobile number, can be double, this can be double, and date of birth should be date with time, and password is double. Instead of double, password should be short text. So whenever any user wants to change the password, if we selected short text, we can enter numerics and alphabets both, but if we selected integer, long integer, double, then alphabets cannot be saved in this field. So password will select data type as a short text. So we'll click, this is the last field, we'll click next. Let Access add primary key. We can choose primary key as our user IDs, but for the timing, we'll create the new additional field as ID, which is auto numbered, and we'll keep it indexed as no duplicate. click next. We can save it, we can name it user table, and we can finish. Okay, we can close it. So this is the table created. So there are some additional fields added, additional rows added. We can delete those rows. Select all these blanks and press delete. Okay. Save. So this is how we create the database. We create the table in the database and we can close it. So this is the temporary database we created with this Excel data. Okay. Now let's go into our VBA, how we access this data, how we set up the database and set up the connections. So if we open the VBA, now let's see some what changes we did. This is all we covered in our previous series. So in order to access the, get the information from Access database, we need to add a reference library to our VBA, to our front end in Excel, called as Microsoft ActiveX Data Object 6.1. So it may be different. 6.1, that number may be different with you. So whatever is the highest number available, it choose that. How will you find it? You will find it in this Microsoft. So here you will find all this object, Microsoft ActiveX Data Object libraries. So whatever has the highest number, we'll select that. So this is the reference to be added to our thing. Then we have to define the connection string to the Access database. So this is the fixed part up till here, microsoft.as.oledb.12.0, and data source is the path of the Access database where it is saved, and jetoledb database password. If we protect the Access file with the password, we have to put the password here. I kept it blank. I stored it as a password protected file, password protected database. Okay. Also, we have to define some constant, some public variable as CON as the ADODB connection. RS is the record set as ADODB record set. My query as the string. My query is the string which is used to get the information, the data from the Access database. This is the field number, record set field number, and for the login purpose, we declare two variables as my user ID and my password. And okay, now what we have to do is for accessing the data from the database, we need to open the connection and then we need to access the record set based on the query we designed. Okay, so I created this one public module, open connection read only. So what it R means, what is read only? RW means read write access. So if it is open read only, we cannot write back to the database. So why I differentiated between the two is, in most of the cases, we'll be only accessing the information from the database, and there is very little information which goes back to the database. In that case, we'll open the connection as read only. So how it works is, we set the connection as new ADODB connection. With connection string is what we define, connection string as public constant here. This is the connection string, and then dot open. This opens the connection with the database. Now we set the record set as the new ADODB record set. See, all this information we can also put in the different modules, different macros, different subs, wherever we want to extract the information from the Access database. So what I did is I created this small sub, and instead of putting the whole information every time again and again, I just call this sub in the macro where I want to extract data from the database. So similarly, this is for read only and this is for read write access. So the only difference is the mode here is AD mode read. Here there is no such mode, so it will automatically open as read write. So also there is one, this is the link where a lot of information available on ADO modules. So let's see, loads. Oh, what happened? Anyway, so okay. Similarly, once we open the connection, after getting the data, we have to close the connection so that all other users can also use this if the same record set to be accessed by any other user. So to close the connection, I first check the condition. If the record set state is open, then close it. If the connection state is open, then close it. If the record set is not nothing, what it means is, if not, record set is nothing means it is not and nothing nullifies each other. It means RS is something. If not, record set is nothing, which means record set is something, then set record set to nothing. So this releases the object record set what we assigned, set RS. This is where we assigned the object to RS, and here we are releasing the object from the variable RS. So this helps in clearing the memory, and your code runs faster. Similarly, if the connection is nothing, then set connection to nothing. So this is to close the connection whenever we open the connection. Second thing about what I created is I created a little error handler in case some error occurs in the during the connection, during the information flow in and out of the database. If some of the variable is not typed in properly, or there's a typographical error, or there's a syntax error, or there is some field missing and we are accessing the number of fields are accessing more number of fields than what is existing, there are many reasons for which the error can happen. So for that I created one little error handler. What it does is it gives me the message, what is the error and what is the description, what is the error number and what is the description of the error. Then we set if RS is nothing, same thing. If not RS is nothing, if record set is something, then we have to do is same thing. RS state is open, then RS end of file is false and base of file is false, then cancel the update and close the record set. Similarly, connection is nothing, close the connection and put my query as a blank. So this should not be my query should not remain open, as it in one macro we assign different query, in another macro we assign different query. So it's better to, whenever we close the connection, we erase the my query string statement. So this is the codes for setting up connection, accessing connection, opening connection and closing connection, and the error handler. This is all I created in the public macro. So in all other macro where we interact with the database, all this will be used. So this is what we already covered. So now let's go to login app. So what it does is, let's say in the login, this is the L login. If I click on it, so this label click calls the login app, this module. So if you go to the definition, this is the login app we created. So with user form 1, L login check visible. What is this? This is the L login check, the label login check. I will make it false first. It will make it not visible. Now we check this if text box, if username value is blank, if we have not typed anything in the username and we click on login, what it says is the login check caption changes to please enter username and login click dot visible equal to login check visible equal to true. What was false here is visible now. What it does is, let's say I open it, I do not enter anything here and I click on login. What it does is this label becomes visible and it reads please enter username. So now if I enter username and I click on login again, now the password field is empty. It says please enter password. So I enter password. So if both the values are correct, then the login is successful. This is what we are doing here. This is what we are checking here. First, we are checking whether the username field is blank or not, the password field is blank or not. If it is not blank, then set my UID, the variable we defined in the public macro, my UID and my password as string. So then we assign the value to my UID, whatever is the value is in the username text box. Similarly, we assign the value to password, my password, whatever is the value in the password text box. Okay, now this is the thing. This is the query which gets the data, which reads the data from the database. We'll go through the syntax a little more. It says select star means everything, select all the fields, all the data from users table, where users table dot user ID is equal to my user ID. This user ID. Select everything from table users table where user ID is this. So how we get this, how do we get this syntax, this statement? So if we open the database, so this is the database. So we can go to create query design users table, we select star, so this appears here star, and we select user ID. So I click not to show this because we are already accessing every field in this table. So I don't need the duplicacy of user ID. User ID is already here in this. So the criteria is, let's say criteria is my user ID. So this is the criteria. Now if I run this query, it gives me the information based on the user ID I selected, and all the fields belong to this user ID. So you right click on this, go to SQL view. Now here it says select user table. Let me zoom in a little bit. What it says is select user dot user table dot star, then from users table, where user table dot user ID equal to this. Now if I delete this user table, it should still work. So this is the statement I generated. Now if I run this, it is still giving me this. Now if I change this user username instead of Tanmur G, user one. So if I run this, user one. So there is, okay, I typed it wrong. User one. So if I run this now, so I get the information of user one from the users table. So this is how we get the SQL statement, the my query string statement from the Access database. What it does is it confirms the statement generated is working in the Excel database, so there should not be the problem when we access it through the VBA. The only difference is when we go to the VBA, where we assign the variable, I have to put this and. See, up till here, what we get from the query, this is exactly same. Up till equal to sign, it is all same. Then we have to add this little column and then quotes and my UID and quotes, this apostrophe and double brackets, double parenthesis, semicolon. The syntax is very important. Even the one missing of one bracket here and there, or the parenthesis or this semicolon, will make a query not to run properly. So this is the query we are generating here. Now the connection, open connection macro we defined. Now we are calling this macro to open the connection, and I'm adding little error handler here in case some error happened within this. So it'll move back to the, it'll jump to the error handler. So what is error handler? Call the connection error handler. This is the error handler which we created. Okay, moving next. So once we have the user ID and the password, which are not blanks, we open the connection. So this is record set dot open my query connection. What is connection? Connection is what we defined as connection as ADODB connection, and this becomes the connection now. Set connection as new ADODB connection and open it. Add open key set, and it is read only. So all this this information you will get it. Let's open that. So here there is a lot of information available on ADO open methods. What are the parameters? What is the description? Parameter source should be, one of the sources SQL statement which we generated. And then this is the active connection, cursor type, log type, and optional. So this is all what how it reads. This is the cursor types, add open key set. What is this? Dynamic cursor. And you can go through the site. It's a very, very resourceful website available, and a lot of information is there if you wish to read. Okay, moving on. So we open the record set. See, here we open the connection, and here we open the record set. Now, with this query, when this query ran in the Excel database, if it returns record count is zero, what it means is record set dot record count is zero, which means after running this query, there is no information available. This is what it means. Record set count zero means after running this query, there is no information available. Then it says incorrect username, cannot log in. So let's test this. If I open this and I enter anything in the password also. So when the query ran with the user ID this, it says nothing, no result available. Record set count dot record count is zero, and it is we cannot log in at this incorrect username. Okay, and then if it happens, then we go to stop login. What is stop login? Stop login is this. We call the connection to close. This is the first condition, whether the given user ID is available in the database or not. If that is available, then second condition which I added, which is not mandatory, but I feel it is in the practical scenario, it is very much mandatory, whether the user is active or not. See, what happened is when we created the database, we put the status as active and inactive. So there is a very, very few chances where we actually delete any user information from the main database. In most of the practical scenario, the information is not deleted. It is just restricted that no further transaction should happen on such IDs, be it any unique IDs. So here what we check is, so let's say here we have user 2 is inactive. Now let me, if we test user 2. So it says user inactive, cannot log in. User exist, password was also correct, but this user is not active. So you cannot continue with the further transactions on the system, on the ERP or on the database. So this is what it is checking. Now again, the if it is 0, then this happens and we go to connection close. Stop login is connection close. If record set is not 0, we found the record set with the user ID. See, we only checking the user ID. Then we check the record set dot field status dot value. The value of this field, if not equal to active, if the value of this field is not equal to active, then it says user inactive, cannot login, and it is equal to and go to stop login. No further login process will happen. Okay. Now, if these two conditions are true, and if record set dot fields password dot value is not equal to my password, if record set dot fields password dot value is not equal to my password is what we captured here when we entered the text in the password field. Then it says incorrect password and cannot login. If we if I enter anything else, so okay, let's change it to user one. User one is active, but I entered the wrong password, and if I click login, it says incorrect password, cannot login. Incorrect password, cannot login. Login dot visible true, go to stop login. Go to stop login, call connection close. Okay, if all these condition fails, now if this is not correct, this is not correct, and this is not correct, what it means is we found the record count, we found the record set with this user ID and it is active and the password is matching, then it means login is successful. Then what happens is dot c current user, c user ID means current user ID dot caption. So what is current user ID? Let me close this user form. This label here is named as current user ID and it will be placed on the successful login below this. I'll show you now. The current user ID dot caption is my user ID, uppercase my user ID. So when we close the connection based on the stop login, so there are three stop logins called, which means the connection is closed, which means login was not successful. Now connection is closed. Now we check the condition to prevent the further code to run in this module. Now if current user ID dot caption is blank, then exit this up. Now, all this will not run and we'll just exit this up. Why it is important is I'm stopping the login process on any of this condition is true. What we are doing is if any of this condition is true, I'm stopping the login process by calling the connection close. And because this has got no value, so I'm checking this, if the current user caption is, current user ID is blank, then exit this up. So it prevents to run this code and it immediately jumps to exit sub. So this is how we are preventing it from unauthorized access. So now if I enter user one and the password, I can log in here. So this is how the login check are implemented in this. First is the two fields should not be empty, and then we should get the correct information which is available in the database. So the user assigned in the users table can only use and log in this. Now another important thing is when we open this, we don't have any menu here. Until unless I log in, then only the menu appears. If I log out, the menu goes away. So this is how we prevent the unnecessary access to any of the other modules. So if everything is okay, let's move further in this login thing. If everything is okay, then the for user or then how we are making it visible is we assign these to, okay, for each control in user form 1.control, if left tag is user UI underscore menu, then make it visible. A simple thing. So whatever is there, all of this have the same tag of UI underscore menu. UI underscore menu. So all of them have the tag started with UI underscore menu. So if the tag is UI underscore menu, then make it visible on the login. That's what we are doing. And on the successful login, we are doing this, making the menu, the left hand side menu, visible. Now, and we are jumping to the home page. So mpg.value, mpg is the multi-page, mpg.value is pages home.index. We are jumping directly to the home page. Now the clicked menu name dot caption. This is okay. So here there are two labels we added: click menu name and hover menu name, which we have seen in the previous videos. So the caption changes to whatever value is here, and then we assign the click menu action just to get the appearance. So what this is doing is, what these two things are doing is, see what is the unsuccessful login. We are jumping back to home page. So on click of login, we're jumping back to the home page, and we're putting the text caption home in the click menu, and then running this click menu action. What it does is, it just highlights this as a selected thing. If I just don't do this and I log out, and let's say user 101, so the logout is highlighted. The previous button was highlighted. So what it does is, it just gives the better appearance that you jump to the home menu and home is selected. That's it. Then we delete the value of my user ID and my password and exit serve. In case of error, jumps to the error handler. So this is our login macro, where we check some conditions, we check the data from the database, and on successful entries, successful retrieval of data, we make the menu available for the user. Similarly, on the logout click, what it does is, first it clears the current user ID caption, which we added here, current user ID caption, and erases the username and the password text field on the login form, and hides the menu item. See, well, this is the same thing what we have, control dot visible true, here is control dot visible false. That's it, everything is same. Here we jump to the home page, here we go, comes back to the logout page. This is the logout page. This is the logout page, this is the home page. So this is all what we did now. Login user, make user, and logout user. So we covered everything in this. In the second video, let me give you a little idea how we are accessing the information is, let's say, login or user. This is the little form we designed based on the data fields available in our database table. So first name, last name, and this is the picture section. These are the documents related to the user. User can update them, and we can add the picture. All this we'll cover in detail in the next video. So what is this here? By clicking of user list, I can retrieve all the users here, and by double clicking on any user, I can get the information here. So this information is directly coming from the database. It is not coming from the list box, or it is not coming from the sheet. It is directly coming to the coming from the database to this form. So let me just a little while show you this, how we are getting it. So this is all we covered. This is all about the login page. So forget password, I have not covered yet, but this is simple thing. I'll cover it in one of the videos and show you. User form initialize is exactly same, no change in that. The only thing we added is, so users, user list, click, get the user list, what we saw here. This is the control name is user list click, users, user list, and we're calling the macro get user list. User ID change. So okay, so what is happening here, let me cover this. When I click on this, I run a macro and get the information of all the users in the users table. Now when I can select it, and when I double click on it, I get the information in the fields above for this user. Now what happens is, when I double click on it, it changes the it makes a change here. Let me show you. This is list box user list double click event, dim I as long with me dot list box for I equal to 0 to list count minus 1. So this is the index of the these are the list count. So it starts with 0, the index starts with 0, so that's why the list count, the number, the index starts with 0, but the count will start from 1, so that's why we are subtracting 1 from this. So if dot selected, if selected item is true, then user ID dot value is the selected, whatever we selected, we gets it here. If I select this, I get it here, this user ID. If I select this, I get it here, this user ID. If I double click, I get it here, the user ID. So in this, what this does is, on the double click event of the list box, it pushes the user ID of the selected user in this text box. So now what happens when something changes in this text box? In this text box, if something changes, we call the load user data. So let's go to this load user data and see. This is the load user data. So what it does is we assign the user ID, assign the value of the user ID to this variable. Similarly, we run the query now. Select everything from the user table where user table user ID is this. Right? It's a similar statement what we saw before. So again, we open the collection, open the record set. If record set not count is not equal to 0, which means is some record found. For I equal to 0, we loop from the record fields. For I equal to 0 to rs.fields.count -1. It's a similar thing. The field index starts with 0, but the count, when we are counting the field, it starts with 1. So the we loop from index 0 to last index. The count -1 is the last index. So user form controls and usr underscore the field name, the first field name dot value equal to the field value. Let's go again. The control on the user fame, control on the username with the name of usr underscore and whatever is the field name. So this is the field name show in the design view. These are the field name, user ID, status, user type, first name, last name, email ID, and these are the field names. So the control on the user form with the name usr underscore and whatever is the field name should get the value, whatever is the field value. Now what, how it happens, the name of this, let me close this. On the users, if you see this is the first name and this is the label and this is the field where the value pops up. So the name of this text box is usr underscore first name. Now first name is the same as the field name in the Access database. Now this last name is the same as in the database. These are all the field name matching to the field name of the database. The only difference is usr underscore this reporting to this. So that's how we are looping it now. This is how we are looping it to get all the text box filled with the whatever value is there in the record set found. Now why I added this on error resume next and on error go to zero. So when we are looping through the record fields, record set fields, and putting that value, record field value, to us and to a control in the user form. Let's say we came to the field of record set password. We came to the field of password. This is the password. Now on the user form, I don't want to show the password. I don't need it. Similarly, maybe there is some other information which we don't want to show on the user form, on the user's information fields. So when the field reaches, when in the loop we reaches to the field RS passwords, it will give me the error and the macro will stop. I want to avoid that. In order to avoid that, we wrapped up in the resume on error resume next and go to zero. What happens if the error occurs? It moves back, it moves forward without popping up the error message and stopping the macro to run. So in case any field is missing from the fields available in the database, it will not give me the error and it will keep on looping through it. So that's how we are getting the information there. And this is how we are getting the list. So similar thing, there are 2-3 methods of getting the list, reading the list from the database. This is kind of the simplest method where we get the header names and then just dump the data, copy from record set RS, and then put assigning the list box row source to the data available in the sheet. This is what we are doing. We'll go through the list box options in detail in one of the separate video. There are 2-3 methods I tested and I'll share with you. So this is kind of the easiest method, but the only thing is the data first comes to the our Excel sheet and from there it pops up in the list box. So user table, this is the user table, this is the data we are getting from the Access database, and then this source from here to here is linked with the list box, this list box. So that's it guys. I think that's enough for this video. In the next video we'll see how we'll update the picture, we'll retrieve the documents, open, add and delete, and we'll see how to search the user from the database directly. We'll try to make it as a predictive search, how it happens when you type in something in the Google and it shows you the predictive search options. That kind of thing we'll try to build for this search option. We'll add the user, and all these options we'll discuss in the next video. Thank you guys. Thank you so much.